السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، أفضل الصلاة والتسليم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما وعملا متقبلا يا أرحم الراحمين. الله teach us what they give us, increase us in knowledge and good morals and in good deeds يا رب العالمين. We are still by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessings talking about Surat Al-Kahf, this surah that we are recommended to recite every Friday, as mentioned in the authentic hadith of our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And we reached ayah 9. In the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu iwaja. All praise and thanks be to Allah who sent the book upon his servant, who sent the book or revealed the book to his servant, and he never allowed any crookedness in it, making it upright. And as a supervisor or a guardian over the other scriptures, and as a guide to all humans, قَيِّمًا لِيُنْذِرَ بَأْسًا شَدِيدًا مِنْ لَدُنْهُ, to warn of a severe punishment from himself, and to give happy news to the believers who do good deeds, that they will get a fine and great reward in which they will remain forever. And to warn those who claim that Allah has children. They have no knowledge of that, nor do their forefathers have. كَبُرَتْ كَلِمَةً تَخْرُجُ مِنْ أَفْوَاهِهِمْ. What a big or a terrible claim that is coming out of their mouths. They are saying nothing but lies. إِنْ يَقُولُونَ إِلَّا كَذِبًا. Perhaps you, O Prophet, about to grieve yourself to death over their denial, if they continue to deny and reject what you came with. إِنَّا جَعَلْنَا مَا عَلَى الْأَرْضِ زِينَةً لَهَا. Surely we have made whatever is on the earth as an ornament and adornment, decoration for it. And surely we will reduce whatever is on it to barren ground. That's the reality of this life. وَإِنَّا لَجَاعِلُونَ مَا عَلَيْهَا صَعِيدًا جُرُزًا. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ كَانُوا مِنْ آيَاتِنَا عَجَبًا. In four ayat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala summarizes the story of the people of the cave, and then he explains in details, subhanahu wa ta'ala. The first ayat of those ayat, do you think, or have you thought that the people of the cave and the plague were the only wonders of our signs? Or were more wonders than the others of our signs? When those youth took refuge in the cave, saying, Our Lord, give us mercy from yourself, آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً, and guide us rightly through our ordeal. So we cast a cover of deep sleep over their ears in the cave for many years. Then we raised them, and upon raising them, people differed about the length of their stay in the cave, and only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows which of the arguing parties or groups knew the real number of the years they stayed in. So, أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ وَالرَّقِيمِ. Have you thought that the people of the cave and the plaque, الرَّقِيمِ is the plaque in which, as we mentioned, their story was written. It's like a tablet on which their story was written or inscribed, or their names or what they used to believe in, their beliefs were inscribed in those on that tablet. Many other opinions for the scholars about that plaque or that raqim. Do you think that they are an amazing thing and wondrous thing when it is compared to our power and sultan? Means it is not. It is not like a very strange thing when you compare it to the power and the qudra of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because the creation of the heavens and the earth and the day and the night and the design of, and the rotation or the revolving of the planets in specific orbits, and all those great signs that tell you about Allah's greatness and majesty, all these are also great signs and even greater signs. So these are not the most wonders of our signs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying. That the fact that he caused the people of the cave to sleep for 309 years and protected them from the sun and all other conditions around them, and that he woke them up later, We have the resurrection that we believe in, which is more wondrous, of course, and greater than just making some people sleep and keeping their bodies, then waking them up. There is, in the resurrection, the whole body dissolves and turns to dust, right? Except for a small piece, as our beloved told us, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith, from which the bodies will grow back again. SubhanAllah, so this resurrection is even, of course, it's a greater sign and a greater miracle when it is compared to what happened to the people of the cave. So do not think that this is the most wondrous or miraculous sign of ours. This is what the ayah is saying. And at the same time, it's not negating that what happened to them is a great wonder and miracle. Of course, it is a great miracle that happened to them. So do you think that the people of the cave, or have you thought that the people of the cave and the plague were the only wonder or more wondrous than the others of our signs when they resorted to the cave? He could have said when they resorted to the cave. Because he said, subhanahu wa ta'ala, أَمْ حَسِبْتَ أَنَّ أَصْحَابَ الْكَهْفِ. Do you think or have you thought that the people of the cave, they were a wonder of our size or more wonders than the rest of our size when they resorted to the cave? He said, the people of the cave, when they resorted, he could have said, when they resorted. But he said, when the youth or when the young men resorted to the cave. Mentioning this word here is very important. Mentioning clearly this word here, al-fitya, has a great significance. Telling us that they were youth, and they were almost close in age, and the youth, we know, they have maturity, they have strength, and they have that, if you like, zeal, right, or enthusiasm to defend the truth, and to stick to their beliefs, and to stick to what they believe in. So this word is very important here. When the youth, when those young men who left all of their luxury, left all of their richness, left their families, left their hometown, and resorted to the cave, subhanAllah, it's very important to reflect on these signs, on these words, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned these ayat in the Holy Quran. إِذْ أَوَلْ فِتْيَةُ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ. When the young men resorted to the cave, فَقَالُوا. Right away, فَقَالُوا. Right away, what did they do in the cave? They supplicated to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. رَبَّنَا, our Rabb. And right away, using a word that is very intimate or close to the believer, this word, Rabb. رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا, رَبَّنَا ارْحَمْنَا, رَبَّنَا, you're our Rabb, our creator, our sustainer, our maintainer, the one who's raising us up in every second, in every breath, in every heartbeat, he's your Rabb, he's taking care of you in every movement. This is a very close word to the believer, and this is why so many dua in the Quran and in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ start with this, رَبَّنَا, or رَبِّي. Right? رَبِّ اغْفِرْ وَرْحَمْ, رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَكَفِّرْ عَنَّا. They said right away, once they reached the cave, رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمًا. And look at this amazing lesson that they did not like stay in their place or... No, they took all precautions and they planned. And there are some narrations like they gathered somewhere and then they... So they did their best and all what they can to save their religion, to protect their identity, to protect their belief. And what did they do? They put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did not depend on the fact that, we found this cave, khalas, we're protected, they cannot reach us. Never. Their full trust was in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمًا. Give us mercy from you, like a special mercy with which you can protect us from those, from our enemies who are trying to force us to leave our religion. Give us mercy with which you give us tranquility and security and safety. Then they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the good end, to give them a good end and a good consequence of this ordeal or this trial that they were going through. رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا. Prepare for us in our affair or in our ordeal a good or a great consequence, a good consequence, a good end. وَآتِنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا. And our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us very nice dua that is close to this. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اللهم وأسألك ما قضيت لي من أمر فاجعل عاقبته رشدا. ما قضيت لي من أمر أن تجعل عاقبته رشدا. Oh Allah, whatever affair you have decreed for me, make its end or make it result in a good end and a good consequence. اللهم ما قضيت لنا من أمر فاجعل عاقبته رشدا. Oh Allah, whatever affair or things you have decreed for us, make their consequence and make their end a good end. Make it something that will be good for us in our dunya, in our akhir. Just like when you make istikhara, seeking the guidance, the prayer for seeking guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In anything you do, it's recommended. It's not only when you want to get married or get a job or in anything, it's good and sunnah to make istikhara, anything important. What do you say? Oh Allah, if this affair or this thing is good for me in my religion, in my deen, and in my dunya, then make it easy for me and facilitate it for me. So same thing here. Also he would say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها. Oh Allah, give us the good consequence in all of our affairs. وأجبنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة. And protect us from the humiliation of this world and the torment of the next world. Protect us from the humiliation in this world and the torment of the next world. أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها. What happened? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answered their dua right away. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prepared for them the things with which they can find that security they asked for. With which Allah pushed away their enemies. With which Allah guided them to the place of the cave. With which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected their bodies intact without any harm. With which they slept for a long time, for so many years. After which, or during which, the whole city changed. And that ruler or tyrant who wanted to impose his paganism on them, he died and he was replaced. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected them. They remained on their religion. And they walked up. Allah walked them up. And they saw their religion being followed. And the religion of their enemies vanished. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them as a sign for others of the resurrection. Some scholars, they mentioned that during the time of the people of the cave, when they, in that time, in that period of time in history, there were some arguments about resurrection and some people deny resurrection. So their story, when they came out and people got to know about it, it came like a proof for those who were arguing for resurrection and trying to prove resurrection for people. So the people of the cave were protected, and they protected others in their beliefs, and their story was a great sign for those believers in their time. The Holy Quran is starting their story with a very important lesson, that you resort to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that you take all of your precautions and do all what you have to do and move. Don't stay in your place. Move and think and plan with all this and before all this and after all this, your trust is completely in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة. It's very important to learn this dua. Very nice dua. ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. فضربنا على آذانهم في الكهف سنين عددا. The answer came and Allah responded to them and He said that we cast ضربنا على آذانهم. We cast like a cover of a deep sleep over their ears in the cave for many years. So this means Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected their hearing. Their hearing remained sound, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as if He made a covering. So like he suspended their hearing for all of that time. If that didn't happen, they could not sleep, right? When you're sleeping, what will wake you up? Just someone shouting or calling you repeatedly, then you will wake up, right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala suspended their hearing without any defect in their ears. Just suspended that hearing, subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that they can have that rest and for many, many years. And all the animals, all the storms, all the rain, all the things around them, it never bothered them because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took care of them. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ And look the word Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using here. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ It's about ba'ath. And here there's like an indirect indication to the pagans in the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who also used to deny ba'ath or resurrection. So Allah is telling us, ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ He didn't say, we woke them up. He said, he's using the word that we use for resurrection. As if he's saying, we resurrected them. We woke them up, and we can woke you up and resurrect you, O pagans who deny resurrection after you become dust. The Quran is amazing. Every word, every letter is there for a purpose. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ Allah woke them up, and they had some silver coins, and they went to the city. And when people saw those coins and they knew that this is not used anymore and it used to be used in the time of the previous kings, they got to know their story and the news spread and people started want to come to see them, etc. And they started arguing how much they spent, etc., etc. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ لِنَعْلَمَ أَيُّ الْحِزْبَيْنِ أَحْصَى لِمَا لَبِثُوا أَمَدًا People started arguing about the time and the length of their stay. And they themselves, they started talking and discussing how much we stayed. Is it one day, like more? And as we will see in the coming ayat, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the details, the point is that Allah is telling us, Allah is the one who knows. He made them, He resurrected them, and of the results of their resurrection, people disputed and started arguing about the length of their stay, and it is Allah alone who knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows and who already knew how much they stayed, and it is only by Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they were able to stay all of those years. ثُمَّ بَعَثْنَاهُمْ لِنَعْلَمَ أَيُّ الْحِزْبَيْنِ أَحْصَى لِمَا لَبِثُوا أَمَدًا There are very important lessons here we can take after mentioning the summary of the story in these four ayat. The first lesson, those were young men and women, or those were young men who resorted to the cave to protect their religion, to protect their faith, to protect their iman, to protect and to make and to secure their eternal future. What about us? What about you, brother? What about you, sister? Have you resorted to the cave? Which cave? There are so many caves. Those people resorted to the cave that will protect them, that will secure their iman. There's a cave that, the cave of resorting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The cave that will protect you from trials and tribulations in this day and age that we live in. The cave that will protect you and remove the doubts that you might have in your mind. The cave that will bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The cave of dhikr, remembrance of Allah. The cave of fikr, reflection on the signs of Allah. The cave of obedience and ta'ah to Allah. For how long we have to keep far from Him subhanahu wa ta'ala, neglecting our obligations, or just fulfilling the very minimum. We have to resort to the cave to the cave of the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Especially the young men and women. As our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us in the hadith that on the day of judgment Allah will provide shade for seven categories of people. As mentioned in that particular hadith, among them, شَابٌ نَشَأَ فِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ A young man who was raised in obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. نَشَأَ فِي طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ He started his life with obedience to Allah. In the most important stage of his life, which is the young age, he came to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, resorted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, obeyed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You need to resort to the cave of chastity, protecting your self from sins, from temptation of others who might seduce you and try to make you fall into the sin. And also our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned this category of people. When a beautiful woman would come to a man and ask him to do the sin, as now it's very open in our times, it comes to your own phone, it comes to your right, to your home. What do? Did you resort to the cave that will protect you, that will enable you to protect your chastity and your iman from sin? He said, I fear Allah. That man who will be able to say that word in the face of that temptation, he must have resorted to the cave of fear of Allah, the cave of knowledge about Allah, the cave of knowing about the consequences of those destructive sins. Especially the young men in their early age, they have to resort to that cave of iffah, of chastity, of protecting themselves. How can they do that if they don't resort to the cave of dhikr of Allah, of building a strong relation with Allah, love for Allah, fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Also, the cave of having brothers who will help you in your way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As also mentioned in that same hadith, two people who gathered and who met, ijtama'a ala Allah wa taqa'a. They met on the love of Allah, and when they part with the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Means their friendship and brotherhood is completely based on the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, based on helping one another to stay on the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is extremely important. Not only here, wallahi, everywhere, in Syria and in Pakistan and in India, everywhere. You need a brother that you love for the sake of Allah, who will help you, a good friend. Did you resort to the cave of longing to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The cave of being in seclusion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as also mentioned in the same hadith, of those people who would be given shade on that hottest and most horrible day, where people will be start sweating. Of those categories of people who will be given shade is what? A person who sat in seclusion to remember Allah, then he shed some tears. رَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. His eyes overflowed with tears when he was reflecting in seclusion. Reflecting about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's greatness and majesty, reflecting about his sins and his relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have you resorted to that cave of seclusion and khalwa and i'tikaf so that you are protected when those trials and tribulations come to you? One of the righteous people, when they imprisoned him, he said, Alhamdulillah, my imprisonment will be khalwa for me. It will be khalwa for me. It will be a time for me for seclusion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What did those youth do in their cave? When they reached the cave, what did they do? Did they just sleep? Or they had that time between them and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, supplicating to him, praying to him, asking him to protect them subhanahu wa ta'ala? They did. The cave, brothers and sisters, that we need to take from these ayat, the cave of fortifying ourselves with iman, with knowledge about this religion, with learning about those people, like the people of Al-Kahf, of the prophets, of the righteous ones, of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, all those people who resorted to the cave, who resorted to the cave that has all those amazing meanings that we all need. When you resort to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, someone can open to the ladies, please. Barakallah. When you resort to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you make dua and you put your trust in Him, He will guide you. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَفِرُّوا إِلَى اللَّهِ. Run to Allah. Flee to Allah. Resort to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. I'll finish with this amazing hadith that our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us to show us that Allah wants you to resort to Him, wants you to go to that cave, the cave of love, the cave of dhikr. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith narrated by our beloved sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whoever comes with a hasana, I will give him 10 and I increase. And whoever comes with a sayyi'ah, he will take a sayyi'ah or I can forgive. And whoever draws to me for a span, I'll come close to him for a cubit. And whoever draws near to me for a cubit, I will draw near him for a fathom. Means always Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is much, much more merciful and more careful for you and about you and more loving for you subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always His mercy is ahead and you just take a smallest step, He will show you mercy double and double and double of all what you do subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ تَقَرَّبَ مِنِّي ذِرَاعًا تَقَرَّبْتُ مِنْهُ بَعْدًا. And whoever comes to me walking, I will come to him at speed subhanahu wa ta'ala. So let's resort to him subhanahu wa ta'ala. And whoever comes to me even with the earth filled of sins, and he comes to me seeking my forgiveness and not associating partners with me, I will forgive him. SubhanAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us of those who resort to that cave, who resort to the cave of love and dhikr and mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah make us of those who listen to this speech and flow its best.
Allahu Akbar.